I'd like to introduce the last member of our table, Alexandra Morris. She has been a staff member of the Alzheimer's Association for 18 years and has considerable experience working with various senior living and families, including management of an adult daycare center, a program for brain injured adults, and a residential facility. At the Alzheimer's Association, she provides community and professional education on a variety of topics, including training in-home and facility staff on success with dementia communication and behavior modification. She facilitates a local caregiver support group and an early stage Alzheimer's support group, working directly with people with early dementia. She has experience as a state certified local resident, has a master's degree in gerontology, and is a credentialed professional gerontologist. So please welcome Alexandra.
I'm used to walking around, but I will try to stay still. Can you hear me? Awesome. All right, so is this my clicker? Okay, so I'm a social scientist. I'm not a medical person. My role today is to provide some real-world examples of how anxiety and dementia, depression and dementia play out in the real world. At the association, we have a 24-hour helpline, numerous support groups, of which one has a leader, education for families and people living with the disease. So the case studies I'm going to share with you are from my work at the association. They're real stories with some of the data changed to preserve at jail. So this is E. So you should have this in your pocket. So 81-year-old female, she's widowed, lives alone. She has two adult children. When we did the care consult with the adult children, they described themselves as drowning. Mom had dementia symptoms, but no official diagnosis. She refused to go to the doctor, who said she was fine. When the daughter kind of spawned her and caught her in for a diagnostic workup, when she realized what was happening, she refused to cooperate and actually left the building. She has very poor insight. She does not know how her behavior affects those around her. In life, she's a very busy woman, an educator, involved in school board, politics, committees. Family believes that she used this busyness, lots of energy, and that's how she managed her anxiety. This anxiety was never addressed medically or otherwise. It was just understood that this is what mom was like. And they believe, in retrospect, that dad sheltered and protected her, did things that she overlooked. They mentioned that she'd be so busy that she'd forget to go there, or she would talk to their woman sometimes, and then I'll take over these responsibilities. So now she's retired and living alone and very likely non-compliant with blood pressure and other medications. She's definitely not on anything, even if she wasn't compliant for anxiety. Now she shops and hoards to fill the time and to create a sense of control. Lifelong impulsivity, more pronounced now that she's retired. Some examples of that was she would show up for the new car. Without exception, she kids would come home from school and there'd be a dog. It was even talked about, there was a dog. Outside of her two adult children, there is no social network. So the way to describe it is that she's very social, active in committees, but whenever someone would start to get close to her, she'd push them away. She impulsively put her house up for sale. The children did not even know until they moved and saw the contract sitting on the counter. But she forgets about the contract. She forgets about the details in the contract and has unrealistic plans on where she's going to live next. She's losing weight. They're seeing poor hygiene, hair, not as clean as it normally was, same clothes. They reported to me in our work together over the years that the release when she seemed like she was wearing the same pair of pants. Still driving, at least at that time, and gotten lost in her car twice. The focus of the care plan, as you might imagine, was risk reduction. How to keep the lady safe. Okay. So, what do we do about all that together? Well, the family, through the realtor, hired an organizer to clean and empty the homeless person dozens, and she was used to working with older folks. She was fantastic. She was very open to coaching around dementia. She fully admitted, you know, I'm used to moving slowly and helping folks to, you know, take care of their home and downsize, and but this dementia thing, I'm just not so sure about this. I think I made some headway, and then the next day it's like we never talked about what it is that we had previously agreed. So she was great working with her. She's very open to learning. And they over time developed a wonderful relationship. We also coached the family on their messages to mom, how to talk to mom, not to push mom, how to ignore the distorted thinking so the mom would say something that just wasn't realistic. Instead of reasoning with her, trying to talk her out of it, they would either ignore it or change the topic and focus on something positive. It was her desire when the house was sold to move to some place in Southern California, near where she had gone to school 50 years before. And she was convinced that she would get this fine in this area because she knew it so well. The family stopped explaining to her that she hadn't spent any kind of time there in the past 50 years, and that was very unreasonable. After coaching, the argument stopped. So we made a lot of headway and then they got better at not reasoning or over explaining and offering better choices. Okay, we worked on hoarding behaviors using steps and concepts from Buried in Treasures by E. Owen. It's slow and kind and reasonable method. Once she moved into senior housing and she moved into independent, why, ma'am? Because they wouldn't take her with her quasi-diagnosis. She was obviously in assisted living. The assisted living places that we were working with insisted that she go into memory care. I understand that. But the woman refused to go. She's too high functioning. She was not conservative. She had no allies, no one she listened to, and instead set against moving into memory care. So she moved into independent. Family hired a friendly visitor to provide driving assistance of errands. That worked out very well. Once we got her used to the idea. The original organizer was so great, stayed on to help us setting up her new home in the independent living and getting connected socially at the residence. This lady, Lee, helped pick out residents that had, for whatever reason, a higher ratio of men, and she was very interested in having the male perspective. That's what she said. I enjoy talking to men. A geriatric care manager was hired to relieve family from the constant challenges, the little mini disasters that seem to happen on a daily basis. So when the family would tell mom when she would call about an appointment that she had forgotten when someone was at her door, or when something was missing, or you know what I'm talking about, right? They'd say, hey mom, we hired somebody to help you with all those little details. Isn't that great? Here's her number. Give her a call. Now, this wasn't easy to coach the families around that, but they started to like it a lot when they realized it was going so well. Driving was still very difficult to manage. She insisted that she was still a solid driver. She was ported to the DMV by the family. Asked the exam, We don't know. I suspect, but I don't know this for a fact. I'm holding to this. But we think some of the DMV is older. Okay, so she passed the exam, so the family said that she gets monitoring system in the car. And eventually she stopped after following her car. Fortunately, no one was hurt in that accident. Medication compliance in the independent living was a constant struggle. Purchased her one of those devices that locks and only opens during the time that the medication is supposed to be administered, and it would say in a pleasant voice, you know, it's 6 o'clock, something like that, time for your meds, okay? But she was frustrated with it. She would get confused about the time that she was supposed to take the meds, I'm supposed to take the meds now. So the family, and actually the GCM reporter, I had a chat with her, she reported that she was actually there when Mrs. E got frustrated with the machine and started shaking it. And then took out the batteries because the darn thing wasn't working right. Yeah. So, you know, when you live alone, so to speak, even though she was in a senior community, it's very challenging. So she ended up moving to memory care after wandering in the fall. Once in memory care, we were able to address the course of medications, and only at that time were we able to give her something to address the anxiety that has plagued her, I would, for decades. And it helped. So it's quite the journey for this family. So the result was risk reduction and stress reduction on this round of the family. There we go. Next case. 7-year-old female, married, 2 adult children. Dementia diagnosis. She had been symptomatic for 2 years before the diagnosis. When we first started working with the husband, he had actually been involved with us in other ways, and now it was more personal. He described the 2 children as kind and attentive to their mother, but they didn't live really close. And so they weren't really involved. And when they first started meeting with us, it was, we're fine. You would say, we're fine. And those kids are busy. They have their careers. They have their own families. You've heard the story, right? So 2 years before, they slowly self-isolated. Before, she was very active. Now she's stopped attending the senior center, does not associate with her friends. And during the holidays, this is what got the husband's attention and why he gave us a call for the care consult. She reported fatigue and did not travel to visit her family out of state. And this was brand new. This is a first time occurrence. But she wasn't willing to travel without him to go and visit the family. The husband reports, at least in the beginning, he reported that she'll still do things with him present. Otherwise, she stays at home, knits, and watches TV. She has some insight into her deficits. It reports that when she's reminded internally or by external events that she has this, that she cries. He reports a lot of depressive symptoms, poor strength, poor sleep, reduced exercise, reduced interest in formally enjoyable activities. The doctor diagnosed her with clinical depression, but husband refuses medication for her. This was his thinking. Of course she has depression. She has Alzheimer's disease. It's a depressing situation. Of course she's depressed. Antidepressants aren't going to make it all right. That was his thing. And he's not alone in that, am I right? I hear this a lot, actually. He reports significant caregiver burden. And this was in the beginning. So in one sentence, he's saying they're fine. And in the next sentence, he's reporting how challenging this is and how many of the responsibilities he's had to pick up. Shopping, cooking, and all of those things. So So the focus of the care plan in this situation is caregiver education, coaching, and support.
Okay.
So what happened? So we coached the husband on the value of treating the depression. We just had numerous conversations. And he started to realize, you know, he talked about, and we talked about, well, regular exercise is good, being out is good, in the sun, right Tai Chi, meditation, all good, good, good. But he couldn't convince her to do any of those things. So he finally capitulated, and she started taking medication. She got better, and she started to engage in some of those things. I hired a friendly visitor to take her on walks and on outings. And they were able to increase levels of exercise. They introduced mindfulness and Tai Chi into her regular routines. The adult children throughout this process were also coached on how to interact with mom. Not to, again, to reason too much with her. Not to remind her that she forgot, not to correct her when some detail of their lives got muddled because their organizational skills more challenged. We're so used to correcting, aren't we? It doesn't come naturally to kind of push that aside, but they're loving, attentive adult children. They took this to the teaching.
The husband began taking her to the senior center. We were able to successfully get her there because he stopped asking. He just said, "Let's go, sweetheart. We're going to the senior center," instead of saying, "Would you like to go to the senior center today?" What a difference such a small thing makes. The husband attended support groups and dementia education ongoing. He's attended many of our conferences and workshops. He hired a maid service. He used a food delivery service, landscaping service. He was finally convinced that, you know, it's okay that I don't do all of this, that we don't do all of this. We provided ongoing coaching for him as new issues arose, and they will, won't they? An example is incontinence. She developed incontinence, and she refused to wear the briefs. And so they stopped going out as much. He was getting really fatigued and overwhelmed with cleaning up after. And they weren't going out as much because of the accidents. So we coached him on what to say and how to get her to wear them. By the way, I'll just tell you really quickly how we did that. We replaced her regular underwear with the briefs. And he told us this, that anything, I just tell her it's normal aging, we coached him, and she says, "Well, how come you don't?" So we said, "Get some for yourself." It worked, guys, okay. Then she started going to an adult day program. She was never really right for an early stage group. I myself have facilitated an early stage support group for the past 8 years. I know the benefits of such a group. But whenever it was brought up and we coached the family on how to bring it up, still she would cry or get angry and say, "I don't want to talk about that. Why would I want to do that?" So, but she was very successful in the adult daycare program. The husband developed a support network through support groups, the adult program, and our events. He was embraced by the Alzheimer's community. And when her activities of daily living were starting to become more and more challenging, he hired in-home help. So the result was the depression was managed, caregiving situation was supported, the quality of life for both the husband and the wife improved. And I'm wrapping up with this. This is a beautiful watercolor painting that I picked up years ago at our art auction, Memories in the Making. If you've never been, wow, you really should go. It's a wonderful time, and creates a lot of awareness and resources towards this. Anyway, I like to show it at the end of a lot of my presentations because it focuses on what's beautiful, still deep in the heart and soul of somebody with dementia, no matter what stage they're in. I was told that the woman who painted this was not an artist. I was told that she was moderate stage. Certainly, in her life, she had strife. And yet, she created this vibrant, alive creation. And I think that it's all of our jobs to facilitate that beauty in the people that we work with. Thank you.